Today we're going to be talking about metamorphic rocks, specifically how they form, the ways in which they can form, and how we can classify them. So let's get started. Metamorphic rocks. In this picture, you can see this really shiny, beautiful rock. It's called a schist, and we call this kind of schist a garnet schist because those clasts in it are garnets, which is a mineral that indicates really high-grade metamorphism. And we'll learn soon that that just means really intense heat and pressure. So let's get started with the rock cycle. And metamorphic rocks, if you remember, are those rocks in the rock cycle that form from deep burial and alteration of igneous, sedimentary, and previous metamorphic rocks that are subjected to really extreme heat and pressure due to this burial. You look at this slide, we can see that metamorphic rocks are forming due to the high pressures and heat associated with plate boundaries. So at subduction zones, metamorphic rocks can form because there's really high pressure from that convergent plate boundary, as well as high heat from the melting magma coming up to form that volcanic arc. And this is what is known as regional metamorphism. The two main types of metamorphism are regional and contact. Regional metamorphism typically occurs at plate boundaries, metamorphosing a large regional scale amount of rocks. Whereas contact metamorphism is a bit smaller scale. It doesn't subject the rocks to as high of pressures, but still subjects them to high temperatures because what happens is a magma body that is rising through the crust can come in contact with previous rock layers that it metamorphoses through contact with those layers. It's not metamorphosing the entire rock layers, but it's metamorphosing those rocks where those rocks come in contact with that magma body. And so it is smaller scale and it doesn't cause as much foliation, which is just squiggly lines in a rock caused by really high pressures. And those are caused more often by regional metamorphism due to that converging compression stress. In our classification of metamorphic rocks, we're going to discuss protoliths on this page. So basically, this is the rock that came before the metamorphic rock. So the parent rock or original rock to its metamorphic product. For example, granite, which we know is an igneous rock, metamorphoses to form gneiss. And you can see in the gneiss these lines, and that's what I meant by foliation. And so that's caused by really, really extreme pressures. Moving on to the right, you can see limestone forms marble when it metamorphoses, and this is just calcite, basically. The marble that you get on countertops may have pretty gray lines in it, and that's just impurities, but typically marble is mostly calcite. The difference between limestone and marble is mainly its hardness. Marble is a lot harder, and that's due to the pressures that the metamorphism, and this is a common thing you'll see with protoliths and their metamorphic product, is that the hardness increases. Another thing that you'll see with marble rather than limestone is that there's no fossils left, and that's because they all got recrystallized because they couldn't retain their form under such high heat and pressure. Next, you can see that on the left we have basalt that can metamorphose to either form green schist or eclogite. Whether it forms either one of these is mainly dependent on the grade of metamorphism, which we'll talk about in the upcoming slides. But you can see that shale's metamorphic product is also dependent on the grade of metamorphism. Low-grade metamorphism or less intense metamorphism will cause shale to form slate, and then further metamorphism, more intense metamorphism, or for a longer duration, slate will then form schist. And here's kind of repeating the same thing. So basically, limestone forms calcitic marble, dolostone forms dolomitic marble, coal can be metamorphosed into more pure coal, basically more pure carbon rather than carbon plus impurities. Sandstone can form quartzite, which is an important one I forgot to include on the previous slide, but basically sandstone is made mainly quartz, right? So when it's metamorphosed, it's pretty much congealed quartz. Instead of quartz grain that you can kind of feel in the sandstone, you can't feel that in quartzite. Basalt can form green schist or eclogite. Siltstone and shale form slate, phyllite, and schist. Phyllite is basically, if we go back to the last slide, it's kind of an in-between look to slate and schist. So imagine something slightly less shiny than this schist, but not as dull as slate. It looks like that. And then granite forms gneiss. And like I said, the ones with multiple metamorphic products depend on the grade. So let's talk about grade. Metamorphic grade is a measure of increasing metamorphism. So whether it be increasing in intensity or duration, this will cause different products to form because those minerals have more time to alter. Low grade metamorphism typically forms products like slate and phyllite, whereas intermediate to high metamorphism forms schist, and high grade metamorphism is typical of gneiss and eclogite products. Metamorphic rocks develop foliation textures, like we talked about those squiggly lines, because of strong pressure. So you can see on the figure on the right where it says foliated texture, that those stress arrows pointing at the rock is the direction of pressure, pushing that rock, basically squeezing that rock until those minerals orient themselves in an elongate pattern, forming these lines that we call foliation. A rock of similar composition that was formed from contact metamorphism does not form that foliation. And so that's something we can use to distinguish between regional and contact metamorphism. Additionally, if you look at the bottom left picture, you can see that banding occurs, and banding is just minerals of different composition that are preferentially forming bands separate from one another. So you can see that the polka dotted mineral type is different than this drapey mineral type in the example that this picture gives, and this causes banding, and that you can see in the farthest right picture on that bottom left figure. So the last thing I want to discuss is a bit more specific classification of metamorphic rocks. We talked about foliation and banding, which can tell you between regional and contact metamorphism, but you can also use composition to determine the protolith or metamorphic grade of the rock, and you can also use grain or crystal size. For example, for composition, if you have a quartzite, you can pretty easily tell that it's all quartz. From this, you can be pretty sure that the protolith was sandstone. Additionally, if you have a slate, you're 100% sure that the protolith was shale, and so on. In terms of grain size, think about gneiss. So as a granite is smushed and smushed under really high pressure, those foliated grains will still be a little bit round. But if they're completely flattened, you can tell something about the metamorphic grade. And these are the things we use to characterize metamorphic rocks. Thank you guys so much for watching. I hope you learned something about how metamorphic rocks can form and the ways in which we can classify them. I'll see you guys next time.